visas and visa-related issues are the cause for many a headache of foreigners trying to move or live in Japan. It can be difficult to wrap your head around the different kinds of visas and what you're allowed to and not allowed to do on these respective visas. Am I allowed to work on a student visa? Can my husband, wife, children accompany me when I move to Japan? Or even starting with the very simple, what is a visa? I'll be doing my best to cover all these topics in today's video. I'll be going over the main categories of visas available for foreigners coming to live in Japan and kind of summarizing what is allowed and not allowed for some of these visas. If you're looking for specific info or advice about obtaining a permanent residency or long-term visa, please check out our seminar webpage. I'll put the link in the description below. And if you register for one of these free online webinars, we'll go over info on these long-term visas, how to get permanent residency, which leads to better financing on home loans, and so on and so forth. This video is not going to cover advice or tips on applying for a visa. This is just a general background info about visas, and it's probably pretty good to know this before applying for a visa to land in Japan. Please keep in mind that the information regarding visas can change. The highly skilled professional visa was recently added in 2012, so I'm going to state that the information in this video is relevant as of February 2021, and if you're watching from the future, there might have been some changes between the time this was filmed and the time you're watching. With that in mind, let's get to the info. So let's start at the beginning. What is a visa? The short answer, it's a permit or document that authorizes an individual to visit another country. There are political reasons for why this is necessary, but that's outside the scope of this video. I just need to talk about what they are and the differences between the ones that you can get for coming to Japan. Suffice to say, depending on your country of residence's relationship with Japan, you may or may not require a visa when landing in Japan, depending on your purpose of stay. Okay, now we understand what a visa is by definition. The next step is to understand that there are different types of visas issued depending on your purpose of stay in Japan. You can only be residing in Japan as long as your purpose of stay, work, school, life, etc., corresponds to the specific visa that you have obtained. If you are in violation of your visa status, you will be subject to fines and/or deportation. This includes things like working under a tourist visa or working under a student visa, although there is a special part-time work application that you can fill out if you are a student who wishes to work at the same time. I'll get more into that later. But anyways, visas are a pretty nitpicky thing, and you'll want to make sure you cross your T's and dot your I's when filling out the application forms. Your Japanese consulate or embassy should have relevant info for you and be able to help you while you're applying for your visa. They should also have the most up-to-date info, so when you're starting your visa application, it's probably best just to get in touch with them anyways. Keep in mind that the entire visa application process can take anywhere from 3 to 6 months. It's pretty lengthy, so you want to set aside plenty of time before you actually need to be in Japan to make sure all the paperwork goes through smoothly. Broadly speaking, visas can fall into one of two categories: short-term visas and long-term visas. Short-term visas are a stay of up to 90 days for tourism, business, visiting friends and relatives, etc. That does not include remunerative activities. On the other hand, stays in Japan in which the applicant will be performing remunerative work in Japan or a stay of longer than 90 days will require a long-term visa. Another difference between a short-term visa and a long-term visa is that a long-term visa allows you to live in Japan and entitles you to many of the rights that a Japanese citizen has, including national health care insurance, unemployment insurance, a pension, etc. Along with this, on a long-term visa, such as a student visa or a working visa, you are allowed to rent an apartment in Japan under a normal 2-year lease. You cannot rent an apartment in Japan on a tourist visa or other short-term visa. There are short-term apartment accommodations, but these are separate from a normal 2-year lease. And while we're talking about visas and property in Japan and visiting or living in Japan, It's important to note that you actually don't have to have residency to buy property in Japan. But it's just as important to note that buying property in Japan does not automatically grant you residency or a special visa for living in Japan, and that financing for buying property in Japan can be difficult if you don't have work history or residency in Japan. But talking about this is going to go beyond the scope of today's video, so if you are more interested in this home buying process, check out the links in the description below, specifically the one on Guide to Buying a Home in Japan, and also get to the seminar webpage on our website. Here you'll see upcoming seminars that we hold over topics like buying a home in Japan as a foreigner. There's tons of info that's covered in detail, and you'll hear from industry experts and bilingual real estate agents. And you'll also get a chance to ask questions in a Q&A session during the seminar. So here I'm going to explain short-term visas, which generally fall under the tourist visa or visa exemption. Japan has an agreement with over 60 countries regarding visa exemption. This means you do not actually need to apply for a visa before landing in Japan. You can state that your purpose of stay is visiting Japan, and you should be granted permission to land in Japan for up to 90 days. If your country is not on this list, you will have to apply for a tourist visa through your consulate or embassy before arriving in Japan. If you are on a tourist visa in Japan, you cannot engage in any paid work here. It's possible to attend a short-term study program in a language school, but if your program goes for longer than 90 days, chances are you should be looking into an actual student visa to stay longer than 90 days. Other things to keep in mind about this tourist visa or visa exemption: when you're in Japan, you are considered a temporary visitor, and this means you can only be in Japan for a total of 180 days during a 12-month period. For those looking for an extended vacation, more than 180 days out of 12 months, there is a extended visitor visa. It's called the specified visa, designated activities, long stay for sightseeing and recreation. This can be approved from 6 months to 1 year. This is basically an option for wealthy retirees because one of the requirements of this visa is having 30 million yen or more in savings, roughly $284,000 USD at the time of filming, but this option is available if you meet those requirements. Student visas. If you're coming to Japan through language school, university, or study abroad program, you'll most likely be coming to Japan on a student visa, unless, as described earlier, you're coming to a short-term program that fits within the 90 days allowed for a tourist visa. A very common question from those who are on a student visa is, can I work in Japan while I'm on my student visa? What kind of work's allowed, etc.? It is possible to work on a student visa provided that you apply for permission to work on a student visa through immigration and that permission gets approved. With that, you are allowed to work up to 28 hours per week, but there are restrictions on the type of work that is allowed. Basically, no working in bars, nightclubs, adult industry work, etc. Now, there are specific visas for cultural activities or trainee purposes, as well as this student visa, but in general, you should probably know which category your situation falls under, but just make sure to check with your school or institution with which one you need to apply for in your case. Along with this, another frequently asked question regarding student visas is, where do internships fall under the umbrella of visas? This is a generalization, and you'll want to follow the guidelines set by your institution, but in general, unpaid internships fall under the cultural activities visa, and paid internships generally fall under a different category, specified visa, designated activities. So there's that to be aware of when you're applying for internships in Japan. Working visas. A visa in this category will allow the holder to work at a full-time job in the respective industry of the visa. There's quite a range of visas that fall under the work visa category, so just make sure you're applying for the one that's most aligned with your industry. If you are working in Japan, you will need your company to sponsor your visa. Most of these visas can be provided from 4 months to up to 5 years, but you'll have to renew the visa if you're staying for longer than the valid period. Now, this process can take a little bit of time too, so you'll always want to prepare a few months in advance before your actual visa validity date ends. And if you change jobs, industries while in Japan, you'll need to fill out a change of status of residence form to notify immigration about this change. Basically, that means you can't arrive in Japan on an instructor visa while teaching and then switch jobs to programming or IT without notifying immigration. You don't want to keep an erroneous record of employment while working in Japan. If you are working under a valid visa in Japan, you can bring your spouse and children or dependents with you on a dependent visa. However, normally those on a dependent visa are not allowed to do work. There is, much like the student visa, a permission to work form that you can fill out, and a dependent can work with limited hours in this fashion. And as an extra layer of complication, those on a highly skilled professional visa who are bringing dependents, those dependents can work without needing to obtain this special permission. The highly skilled professional visa. As mentioned earlier, this visa was introduced in 2012, so it's pretty recent. It uses a point-based system to determine whether an individual qualifies for this type of visa. Things like having a doctor's degree, more than 5 years of professional experience in your industry, a high salary, Japanese language proficiency will all give you higher points in determining whether or not you qualify for this visa. This kind of visa is special in that it allows the holder to engage in multiple types of activities while staying in Japan. Normally, you're not allowed to kind of dip into different areas that are outside the bounds of the visa that you hold, but on this type of visa, you could. For example, if you had a highly skilled professional visa and you were engaging in research work at a university, you could simultaneously run your own business if you wanted. Those on the highly skilled professional visa are also granted the maximum of 5 years of visa validity uniformly. Other visas are issued in varying lengths of validity, but this visa is automatically granted at 5 years. It's easier to obtain permanent residency if you have a highly skilled professional visa. In most cases, you have to live in Japan for 10 years consecutively to meet the requirements for permanent residency, but this requirement can be shortened to just 3 years for those on the highly skilled professional visa, and in the case of those who are particularly skilled, who score 80 or more on their evaluation, can find that the path to permanent residency is shortened from 10 years all the way down to just 1 year of living and working in Japan. Another advantage of the highly skilled professional visa is that your spouse accompanying you will be able to work full-time without needing to apply for permission through immigration. Normally, on other long-term visas, if your spouse is accompanying you and they also are non-Japanese, they would need to apply for permission to engage in work while on the dependent visa, but this permission to work still limits the number of overall hours they can work per week. But if you are on the highly skilled professional visa and your spouse is accompanying you to Japan, they are able to work full-time without needing to get special permission from immigration. There's other benefits for applying for this visa as well. If you're curious, there's a terrific write-up on our blog, so check the description for the link to Highly Skilled Foreign Professional Visa for Japan to get more info. And on top of that, remember, we hold seminars about this kind of visa and other long-term visas, so click through to the seminar webpage and find a visa seminar and register for it if it fits your schedule. Working holiday visas. If you're a citizen of one of the 26 countries with which Japan has an agreement with regarding the working holiday program, then you're able to apply for a working holiday visa. Spoiler alert, this does not include the USA. However, for those who can apply for a working holiday visa, this is a great way to get some experience with living in Japan. This visa does not require a company to sponsor you. In fact, the working part of this working holiday visa is less emphasized than the holiday part of the working holiday visa. You need to provide proof that you will have enough funds to sustain yourself during your stay before being approved. But if you find a job before coming to Japan, most likely you should be applying for a regular work visa. Some general info about the working holiday visa program. This is available for those around 18 to 30 years of age, but different countries have different age restrictions. There's a limit on how many individuals can receive this working holiday visa depending on the country. No dependents allowed while on this visa, so you cannot bring a spouse or child with you when you are on a working holiday visa. This is a one-time visa. You are not allowed to have one working holiday in Japan and then apply for it a second time. While on the working holiday visa, you are not allowed to work in gambling establishments, nightclubs, etc. You'll probably want to check with your consulate or embassy or immigration for the exact details of what work is considered allowed under this visa. Spouse visas. If you're married to a Japanese national, you can apply for a spouse visa when living in Japan. Those on a spouse visa are permitted to work in any field within the bounds of normal legal work. Keep in mind that a spouse visa does have a validity period very similar to the previous visas that we were talking about, and it needs to be renewed every so often. It is not a permanent visa. I don't have firsthand experience with this, but during the spouse visa application process, you'll have to provide information about your relationship. Things like when and how you met, which is charmingly referred to as developments leading to the marriage in the official documents, how you and your spouse communicate, in what language, date of your marriage, info about your relatives, along with photos that show you and your partner together. So it's a pretty complicated process. If you get divorced in Japan while on a spouse visa, the immigration office might revoke your spouse visa 6 months from the day of the divorce, which means that you'll have to switch your visa if you wish to stay in Japan during this time. Now, if you've lived in Japan long enough, usually 5 years consecutively, you might be able to switch into permanent residency. But for more info, you'll want to contact authorities and experts in immigration so they can help you with your situation. Permanent residency. For lifers who foresee living in Japan for the long haul, permanent residency is the natural path to take. There are requirements such as have been living in Japan for an extended period of time, generally 10 years, but in cases of having a spouse visa or on a highly skilled professional visa, this time can be shortened to 5 down to maybe even 1 year. If you have permanent residency, you will no longer have to renew a visa, but you will have to update your residency card every 7 years. However, I'm led to believe that this is a fairly painless process compared to renewing a visa. Those with permanent residency will also see better financing options when applying for home loans. Naturalization. I debated whether or not this info was actually relevant to a video on visas, but I thought it was interesting enough to add a little bit of a blurb here. It is possible to naturalize and become a Japanese citizen. This means you'll have to renounce your citizenship of your home country. And basically, what you can do as a Japanese citizen that you wouldn't be able to do under permanent residency or long-term visas is voting in elections and running for public office, along with other public service type work becoming possible, like working as a judge or police officer, etc. But this is just a brief mention of naturalization. I'm not going to go into the process of it. There's probably way better resources out there for those interested in the topic of becoming a Japanese citizen. Status of U.S. Forces Agreement, SOFA. If you are a member of the U.S. Armed Forces and you will be stationed in a base in Japan, you do not need a visa, but you will need to provide military ID and your military orders upon landing in Japan. In addition, civilians or dependents accompanying members of the U.S. Armed Forces moving to Japan also do not need a visa, but they will need a valid passport. I would assume that if you're moving to Japan on this path, that the military has a very streamlined way to get you to where you need to go. So this covers the basic types of visas for entering Japan. There are some specific case visas like the diplomat visa, etc., but I think those are much more on a case-by-case basis. Definitely, it's in your best interest to get started early when researching different types of visas and applying for the visa for your stay in Japan. Contact your embassy or consulate for the details on the paperwork that you'll need, because this process can take upwards of 6 months. And for more info on long-term visas like the highly skilled professional visa and the investor/business manager visa, definitely check out our free online webinars. There's tons of great info in there for those interested in obtaining one of these visas and info for those interested in the path to permanent residency in Japan. I'll put some links down below in the description that'll point you in the right direction on our website. As always, thanks for watching. I know this is a huge topic and there's a lot to talk about visas. And if you found the info in the video useful, please subscribe to the channel or click the like button. It'll help get the video out there, and that way I can make more videos focusing on moving to and living in Japan. So that's gonna do it for me today. Take care, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.